All right, welcome back. You are watching KTN Sunday Edition. We're now on to our main discussions here with my panel, Professor Weri Tumbo, political commentator, Brian Mutie, governance expert, and Dismas Mokua, who is a political risk analyst. It took a while before I get used to calling it that. But away from the primaries, we'll be definitely getting back to that, as well as the president's apology. Something phenomenal also happened this week. Party leader of Chama Chamashinani and Bomet County Governor Isaac Ruto officially joined NASA as the fifth principal. He was welcomed by the four principals at the Bomas of Kenya. Let's just take a look at that story by our senior reporter Rita Tinina before we dissect into that. NASA,
NASA, NASA. After weeks of anticipation on the choice of the NASA flag bearer, the opposition coalition had something to report.
And we have made tremendous progress in arriving at the lineup that is going to lead this country.
NASA says it has already agreed on a power-sharing arrangement, with reports indicating that the coalition will, among other things, create the position of chief minister if it takes over power.
Munajua katika mila zetu, ngombe inagawanywa kabla ya kuchinja. Nani atabeba mguu ya nyuma? Nani atabeba mbavu?
But supporters will have to wait one more week. The coalition will name its flag bearer on Thursday next week during a rally at Uhuru Park, and the principals are making an assurance.
None of us will walk out of this arrangement.
When we do hit the road, it will be a campaign like no other.
The announcement will be made just a day after the IEBC deadline on party nominations. NASA now has five principals after the new kid on the block, Chama Chamashinani leader Bomet Governor Isaac Ruto, who says he has no presidential ambitions, was officially received into the coalition.
Najiunga katika harakati ya kukomboa inji yetu.
Have today relaunched the Pentagon. It's the new Pentagon.
And we want to make sure every vote counts. Nobody is too small.
The entry of Isaac Ruto does not change the equation in the search for a flag bearer, a process that has in recent weeks shaken the coalition's unity. With next week's much anticipated announcement, the coalition will be preparing to hit the ground running in its presidential campaigns. Rita Tinina, KTN News.
All right, that story by our senior reporter Rita Tinina brings us to our discussion at this point. The fifth principal of NASA, Bomet Governor, joining the National Super Alliance, and of course, together with his party, Chama Chamashinani. He says he brings in 1.2 million voters to the NASA basket. Do you agree with him?
I'm not sure about the 1.2 or 1.5 million votes, but he will certainly bring some votes. For me, this announcement is a major, major blow to Deputy President Ruto's control of Rift Valley. Consider that Pat Kericho and Bomet constitute almost 50% of all the votes that Ruto controls. Yeah. So if a sizable portion of that vote goes to NASA, it is quite problematic. Secondly, to me, his coming is very well calculated, because you could see, even when he was making the announcement, people, or even when they were having an argument in primaries, people were saying it is a Jubilee nomination exercise, but they were doing this.
Yes, especially in Kericho.
In Kericho, they're doing this, which means underneath their CCM, in public, they are Jubilee. That, to me, is a red, is a, what you would call in American terms, a red line. They have crossed it, and the DP cannot do it. Let me make one more point. There is a very important thing that is all over. This sort of shake, vibrations underneath Rift Valley, which seem to be evidence that there is discontent, itself should be worrying Jubilee like hell. Let nobody put on a what you might call a brave face on this. Mm. This is something they must go to work on very hard with the view to persuade, not to bully. Because the deputy president campaign approach is you get bullied into submission. Mm. Now, in this particular circumstance, what is required is persuasion, is negotiation, is pleading.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I think it has potential to create trouble.
Brian, this move by Isaac Ruto has been termed as the biggest political gamble of this particular election that we are heading into. Do you agree with that? Do you think it's a risk for him?
It is. It is a big risk, and this month will actually ascertain to that when he takes over.
Why are you so sure about that?
As a risk analyst, of course.
Sure.
That's for the credit.
Yeah, of course. I just wanted to say that the spirit of this whole arrangement was the rebirth of the Pentagon. Mm-hmm. All along, Odinga has been actually looking for a situation where he would want to have a face of the country in his NASA platform. And he has been working underneath to ensure that he persuades people of the likes of Isaac Ruto. And finally, he was able to catch the big fish from the Rift Valley voter, which is on Isaac Ruto. But what Isaac Ruto brings on board, apart from the 1.5 million votes, as we want to be told, I think it is that kind of statement from NASA that, look here, guys, we are able to penetrate even in your bedroom.
We've made inroads.
We have many inroads, including your bedroom, which is the Rift Valley, which is perceived to be the Jubilee's bedrock. And again, I want also to say that Isaac Ruto is coming as a strategist. He's not just a pushover. He's a man who is so much likable when he takes on the podium. He's able to draw upon votes to himself instantly. He's able to mobilize through his power and his ability to infuse humor into politics. I think, to me, is one big fish that NASA should be proud of. But again, I think the problem with NASA, as much as it wants to play through the galleries of the initial Pentagon, I think they are still grappling on how to balance that face of the country. Look here, we have two lawyers in the NASA family, but they do not have the other constituents being represented. They ought to have somebody from, Mount Kenya region. They ought to have somebody from Meru. They ought to have somebody from the coast. But I do not want to preempt on what they are going to tell us on Thursday when they unveil their team. Perhaps they will have actually, incorporated those faces in their team.
Dismas, should the deputy president and Jubilee at large be worried about this move made by Isaac Ruto?
Now, the two scenarios, Akisa. The first scenario is assuming that Isaac Ruto doesn't have political capital. And the last opinion poll done by TIFA Research indicated that he was merely 1 point ahead of Laboso. So depending on who beats who, Laboso and Konez, if they decide to unite forces, there's a very high chance, depending on how Isaac does his mathematics, that he may actually lose an election. So what Isaac Ruto has actually done, and when you look at the coalition instruments, the one for NASA, he has secured himself a seat in the cabinet if NASA wins. Mm-hmm. Because every principal is allowed to appoint two cabinet ministers.
Yeah.
So assuming he doesn't retain his position as a governor, he would tell his principals that I'm appointing myself and another person. So that's one scenario. Then the next scenario, assuming that in fact he's got a political capital, the first thing is about perception. Because what NASA is wanting to create today is the bandwagon philosophy or propaganda, saying that everybody is joining NASA. If you're not part of NASA, then you're in the losing team. So in terms of perception, it's working very well. Number two, the deputy president has got a gift of the gab. He knows how to do propaganda very well. Mm-hmm. And in Isaac Ruto, he gets an equal match. Because when you look at Raila, Kalonzo, Wetangula, and Musalia, they're not able to match the deputy president when it comes to his oratorial, prowess in the public place. But Isaac Ruto can take the deputy president word by word. And he's going to do a very good job. And then number three, Isaac Ruto has been a rebel all his life. You recall at some stage when he was a minister and he had an altercation with President Moi, he was left stranded at an airport in South Africa.
South Africa.
Mm. Now, you need that kind of a rebel rouser within NASA to make Jubilee uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Given the fact that it's him and the deputy president who created URP, so he knows so many things. But I think most important, number three, I don't know if the gentlemen are laughing. Am I taking a lot of time?
finish up.
Yeah, the last point is, he has created now opportunities or choices in Rift Valley. Mm-hmm. In the past, everybody in Rift Valley was told that since tunanyumba yetu ni Jubilee, so all of you have to come to Jubilee. But now he's giving people in Rift Valley choices. Options. He's telling them, if you're unhappy with the Jubilee, come to NASA. And when you come to NASA, I'm a significant player, I'm a principal. When you take over government, I'll be able to give you bread. And the last point, the deputy president stands accused of not giving many members of the Kipsigis community positions in the cabinet. And Isaac Ruto can latch on that and say, when we take over, I'll give you preferential treatment. Mm-hmm. So Jubilee must be very worried. If they're not worried, then they're not able to do the risk analysis.
Is this a big win for NASA? Do you all agree that this is a big win for NASA?
It as I said earlier, and which links up to what this man has just said. Yes, the other day, during the primaries, some parts of Uasin Gishu were saying, if you don't want us in Jubilee, we'll go to CCM openly on the street, which confirms what this man is saying. They are saying, look, this guy has created a new Simba. We have got shelter and we've got a platform. Now, the interesting thing that is in all these things is extremely important, that if you look very carefully, very, very carefully, in contrast to the vote that supports Uhuru Kenyatta, Ruto's support base is fragmented into sub-units.
Yeah.
So each sub-unit can stake its claim and take a position where they will be best served. Now, this then creates a problem for what you call the Kalenjin. Now, this Kalenjin thing is an operating concept, but and it has got an operational, I mean, an ethnic component.
Yes.
But when you go to the ground, you will find that Deputy President Ruto has, over in my assessment, rewarded the minorities in the Kalenjin collection.
And that's why he gets himself
now, support. And now those are his supporters. The ones that are feel ignored are those are the ones that will require detailed risk analysis. Because that
we have a political risk analyst as well.
Out there, quite clearly, irrespective of how they subdivide, Isaac Ruto has played a major blow to Jubilee. And they really must think about it.
All right, okay. I'll let you have the last word on this.
Sure. I think I just want to tie the two contributions by my two member panelists. You had asked initially what he actually brings to NASA, and I want to look at this issue in a comparative way with the pollings that were done in 2013 and the outcome. Comparatively, you could see that the margin that Jubilee beat NASA, I mean, or CORD by then, was to the tune of maybe less than 1 million, so to speak. When you look at the players who are on that ring, were the likes of Wetangula, Kalonzo, and Raila. Now that with the entry of Mudavadi, who actually earned himself 500,000 votes in 2013, and also a good number coming from Isaac Ruto, we are likely to see actually the game coming to change completely in terms of numbers when it comes to the general elections this year. And I'm saying this because as much as Jubilee says that it has made inroads, which we do agree that it has made some, you know, significant inroads in Kisii, parts of the coast, I mean coast per se, parts of the Narok and Kajiado, Ukambani as well, and also parts of Western Kenya. If you look at that collectively and compare with what NASA is able to spring come August, I think it will be a very close one. And this is thanks to the entry of Isaac Ruto. And I'm likely to say that for the first time we are likely to see a runoff in this year's general elections. And I'm saying this because if you look at the chunk of votes that will come from Rift Valley thanks to Isaac Ruto, will be so huge according to how he's going going to play his cards well as far as NASA is concerned. And again, how Jubilee is also going to manage the fallouts within its house. It's going to be a close one this time around that we are likely to see for the first time, you know, a runoff in these elections.
All right. I'd like us to close on that. We'll get back to a topic we've quite touched on earlier on. The president yesterday spoke to the nation, apologized to his supporters or the supporters of the Jubilee Party for how bad the party primaries turned out. Let's just take a look at that before we get into it.
While the party, and that is our Jubilee Party, was prepared for a normal party primary, we were confronted instead by a full-scale general election in terms of the sheer massive turnout that we all witnessed. We take this opportunity to say that to the millions of party faithful who turned out to vote, and to the thousands of party aspirants who turned out to compete for our party's ticket, we unreservedly apologize for the underpreparedness, for the magnitude and scale of the nomination exercise. As I have repeatedly said, the Jubilee Party is committed to free, fair, transparent, and credible nominations, which, as we have repeatedly stated, must reflect the will of the people. Because of this commitment, we also took another unprecedented and very difficult decision to cancel the entire nominations exercise, because doing anything to the contrary may have resulted in a subversion of the democratic will of the people. It is not that we were unprepared. We were underprepared. We were underprepared for the sheer scale of turnout that was witnessed. And therefore, we did not have adequate material. We are not interested in what the opposition is doing. Let them run their affairs. We are running our affairs. We are just appealing to our people. Be patient. Allow us to prepare ourselves so that you can have your say in terms of who shall represent you as a Jubilee candidate.
All right, that was a statement by the head of state at a State House yesterday here in Nairobi, apologizing to his supporters or the supporters of the Jubilee Party and saying that their only mistake was that they were underprepared. They did not expect the overwhelming number of people who turned out to participate in that particular poll. And yesterday night during our primetime news, we asked our viewers whether they believe Uhuru's assertion that the only problem for Jubilee was the overwhelming number. A huge chunk of them said no, there were bigger problems than just them being underprepared. Do you agree with that?
As I had said earlier during the opening of this program, what the president was doing was damage control, was simply trying to assure their people that we've done badly. We don't have a very good reason to give you, but please give us a chance to do it. The incredibility of his statement arises from the fact that they have been boasting all along, during which they should have been planning. And I have said elsewhere before that if you fail to plan, you are planning to fail. And I said that somewhere, and as the primaries proceeded, they continued to fail as the day proceeded. Now, the problem, if you look at what was happening, there were information flow problems. There were transport problems. There were printing problems. There were procurement problems.
So in essence, everything was a problem.
Shambolic. So saying that they were underprepared. By the way, I want to make a rather tenuous argument here. Now, if you look at what happens, that's what happens daily at national level. That's how the government operates. They go into things they have given. In fact, their primary problem in this nomination was a personnel sourcing, the sort of people they put in charge of their programs. Mm-hmm. If they had gotten a competent project manager, not Tuju. Tuju is a competent propagandist. He is not a competent manager of a political establishment.
So would you blame him for this failed polls?
He must take responsibility. I mean, you can't be the boss and then refuse to take the responsibility for the boss's position's failures.
Brian, most of the aspirants on a Friday were calling for the resignation of Raphael Tuju, saying he had failed the whole party and had embarrassed the president. Should he be taking responsibility, as Prof says?
I think he did it, and he took a partial blame on the whole process. And again,
but should it be more than that?
I think that will be on the extreme. Because at this stage, this is a political process, a case for crying out loud. Mm. And changing the pilot when the plane is airborne, I think you are creating a recipe for, you know, a catastrophic landing.
Yeah.
And therefore, this man carrying out the institutional memory of the party can only be allowed to continue with the process, but with some sort of, changes in terms of backups and in terms of reviewed terms of reference. The reason why I'm saying so is because Tuju, being such a sober fella as we know him, I think he's able to handle the crisis that has been significant in Jubilee House with this sort of, professionalism. He's not a temperamental person. Mm-hmm. We want to say that he's actually being affected by, changing in mood swings and all that. And therefore, I think for me, as a moderate person, I think I would want to see a situation where I'm putting myself in President Uhuru's shoes.
Mm-hmm.
Look here, these are players who are not scoring. But instead of changing the whole team, you can create some sort of substitutions here and there.
Or fire
not
the
changing
coach,
the whole team.
You fire
like
the coach.
We
you
see don't in, the, coach. In actual football matches.
You don't fire the coach immediately. Yeah. When the game is happening, you know, remember this match is happening, Professor.
Yeah.
You don't fire the coach when the match is already in play. You just make some substitutions, some changes here and there.
Then later on, fire the coach.
Good.
Well, all right. I leave that to this man maybe to complete
that. No, but of course, on a lighter note.
Oh, yes, sure, of course.
Well, I don't know. I'm not much of a man when it comes to soccer. But when ODM party's primary fail, we blame Raila Odinga. We don't look for Judy Perena and say Judy Perena has been a failure. And I suspect if Judy Perena was in the streets in Nairobi, most ODM aspirants wouldn't even recognize the face. So when Jubilee primaries fail, you cannot blame Tuju. You cannot blame Msangi. You blame the president and his deputy. Because it's the president and deputy who gave Tuju the responsibility to run the party primary and appointed Msangi as the director, or rather the chairman of the National Elections Board. So you can blame the president and his deputy for poor talent search that are in the event that it's actually Tuju who made this fail.
Yes.
Because again, we are told that there are powerful cartels that may have compromised the quality of this process. But at the end of the day, the buck stops with the president. And yesterday was very pleasant to me, because for the first time, you actually have a head of state coming to apologize, accepting liability, that we made a mistake and pleading for...
Was there any other way around it?
I mean, he would have decided to enjoy his cup of tea and he doesn't show up, and then an announcement comes from...
Wouldn't that
party.
Be risky? You're that a risk, political
risky.
Risk analyst.
Risky analyst.
That would have been very risky, but that's what I'm saying. I mean, he would have come yesterday to issue a statement and he doesn't apologize and say the new dates for our party primaries is on Monday and Tuesday. I'm asking all aspirants to cooperate. He's under no obligation to apologize, but he did.
Yes.
And obviously,
but how would that appeal to his
that's leadership.
Supporters?
Of course, the Jubilee brand right now is a bleeding. You saw pictures I saw the Standard yesterday. There was actually a photo of the Jubilee ballots are going up in flames.
Sure.
So the brand is really bleeding, and it was important for the president to say that. But Akisa, let's go to the semantics. Underprepared, overprepared. Really, that is really Victorian English, because as it is, the voter in Muranga who woke up early in the morning wanted to go and cast a ballot in favor of a particular candidate. So she doesn't care whether or not you're underprepared or overprepared. But the good news for the president is the amazing voter turnout. which should worry NASA. Mm-hmm. Because in those sections, you saw queues, especially in Kiambu, winding for miles on end, which shows that the Jubilee voters are actually going to wake up early in the morning and go cast their ballots in favor of their candidates, whether they're going to endorse them, whether they're going to pick them, whatever the case.
All right.
And it also should worry NASA, because in a majority of their strongholds, the voter turnout is as low as 10%. Like, for instance, in Kitutu Chache constituency, where you have 55,000 registered voters, it's only 5,000 who came to vote in the party primaries. Mm. And that should worry Mr. Raila Odinga and his
NASA team. But you might also want to take a look at the names that are involved. When you take a look at Kiambu, we have a battle royale there of William Kabogo, the incumbent, and Ferdinand Waititu. Surely you would expect a huge turnout for that. Those people command a huge support.
No, but still, really, at the end of the day, really, that should make the president very happy, that he's been able to test the waters, and he now knows that if his deputy is going to oversee a party primary, which people would say is credible, then he shouldn't be worried of the NASA propaganda of a voter apathy in mm-hmm. this part of the world.
All right.
That there's going to be massive voter turnout. I think the person who should now be having sleepless nights is NASA. Because how do you have 10% of registered voters coming to vote for a particular mm-hmm. candidate? And
I want us first to yes. listen to, sorry to cut you short, I want us first to listen to what Raphael Tuju said. He held a press briefing hours after the president did yesterday in State House. Let's just listen to him and then get back to the discussion.
I can read the timetable. It's very long, so the best thing, I think, is just to mention the highlights, and then we'd ask you to go onto our website, because it's been posted there. And if any of you require a copy of the press release, then you should be able to get one. We are going to continue with the primaries on 24th, 25th, and 26th. We have divided it just to reduce the pressure on our logisticians, who have asked for more time to be able to do this. So Nairobi is definitely taking place on Monday. Baringo, Elgeyo Marakwet, Kirinyaga, Bomet, and Nandi. I'm mentioning those in total so that those who are preparing themselves for Monday can continue to make those preparations. The others are slated for Tuesday and Wednesday. And I would like to also add that because our people in charge of logistics are still working on this, in the unlikely event that they tell us anything that, you know, there's any kind of hitch, like let's say some ballot papers, they have counted them and they are not enough, we don't want to make the same mistake twice. So if they tell us, sorry, we're not ready for this place, we will give the update to all our aspirants through the media, and we'll give the update to our officials, both through the media and directly through the forms of communication that we have directly with them. As if I can say, Tuesday, we have Lamu, Wajir, Mandera, Marsabit, Turkana, Samburu, Kilifi, Tana River, Mombasa, Kitui, Machakos, Makueni, Kakamega, Vihiga, Bungoma, Busia, Homa Bay, Migori, Kwale, Garissa, Nyamira, Isiolo, Kisii, Kajiado, Kericho, Murang'a, Kiambu, and Uasin Gishu. Then most of the earlier planned nominations, which were already slated for that day, we've kept them there, but we've added a few more of the repeats. Now, on Wednesday, we have Nyeri, Laikipia, Embu, Taita Taveta, Nyandarua, Narok, Nakuru, Meru, Tharaka Nithi, West Pokot, and Trans Nzoia.
All right, Secretary General of the Jubilee Party there, Raphael Tuju, yesterday addressing a press briefing, giving out the new dates that are scheduled for the Jubilee Party primaries to take place Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday, the 24th, 25th and 26th. I want us each to just give a statement on what you expect. Do you expect anything better next week from Monday from the Jubilee Party? I'll start with you, Dismas, quickly.
Of course, yes. You know, the fact that the deputy president now has taken charge, and people know the president, know him as a bully, somebody who wants results delivered. So there's a very high probability that the results are going to be credible. But I think moving forward, we should have these party primaries held on a on one day across the nation, done by IBC, and then that day is declared a public holiday, so that people don't go to work on that particular day. We all go and participate in our party primaries.
Brian.
I don't want to delve on much of what you said, that we need to make that nomination day and holiday for mm-hmm. us, because we all belong to different political parties, yeah. and somebody on ODM will not really, you know, find it, you know, that important to be offered an holiday just because Jubilee is actually having their D-Day.
So do you think they will get it right this time?
Oh, yeah. Well, I think it will somehow improve now that the DP, the number two, has taken over. And I'm saying this because as much as we want to see a perfectionist in the whole process, it's not going to be easy. It's not going to be forthcoming. Mm-hmm. There will be some pockets of issues here and there,
yeah.
because the nomination process will never be a seamless affair. There will always be these kind of eruptions, chaotic violence here and there. And this is not exceptional to this time around. And I'm hoping that they are going to learn to take into account what they have learned from their mistakes.
All right.
And perhaps enrich the good, you know, lessons learned to ensure that they have a better nomination process.
All right, Prof,
I want to make three quick points.
Yes.
I don't share the view that your threshold is the average. You know, he decides that it is so bad you start somewhere in the middle.
Mm.
To me, demanding the best from our systems, from our leaders, is an imperative we must aim for.
Okay.
Not start as the average is the best,
all right.
then you go from there. The second thing, I expect this next round here, Jubilee, to be better than it can't be worse
mm-hmm.
than what it was.
Yeah.
I expect it to be better. Mm-hmm. But I also expect now that William Ruto is in charge,
mm.
I expect definitive fallouts.
Mm-hmm.
There are not going to be people who know that their chances have now been completely.
And lastly, I want to make
one last one.
All right.
Now, it is important if you look at Jubilee, the shareholders are Ruto and the